shalom, brethren in Yeshua, the Messiah. Here I am in my prayer shawl again. And just going over some more wonderful Torah readings, this time from the Proverbs. Although it's not directly from the Torah, it's from the Tanakh, of course. But written by the wisest man who ever lived, except one, of course, Yeshua. I'm just going to read through some of chapter 8. Better is the poor that walketh in his uprightness than he that is perverse in his ways, though he gain wealth or be rich. So again, this is Yeshua's parable about he came to make the rich poor and the poor rich. In other words, the riches of God's kingdom are the things that Yeshua came to give. He didn't come to give us big mansions and, you know, Mercedes and Ferraris and all that stuff. You know, as Joyce Meyer and her little crew would have you believe. You know, the prosperity gospel, the false gospel. Came to give us the riches of his kingdom. It says, who keeps the law is a wise son. Now, who would ever... I mean, I know it's logical, and I know that it makes sense, but what Christian would actually teach their children this? I don't know very many, to be honest with you. They might teach them about Christian values and going to church and so on, but keeping the law? I mean, yeah, maybe keeping men's laws and traditions. You know, like the Pharisees taught their children. That's about as far as Christianity really goes. He that by usury and unjust gain increases his substance, he shall gather it for him that will pity the poor. I wonder, it doesn't make total sense to me. I would have to really sort of check out the original words in this. But it kind of is along the lines of that the wealth of the wicked is stored up for the just. I think that's a proverb as well. So it's along these lines. And let's pray that these things come to pass, because I know a lot of, the poor getting poorer at the moment in the world, you know. Read that one out. He that turns away his ear from hearing the law. So, you know, Yeshua talked about, you know, don't be a hearer. Don't just be a hearer. It's important to hear the law, which a lot of Christians won't even do that. They'll never read. They'll never actually go through the entire Bible. They'll go through maybe two or three Gospels. Maybe their favourite Gospel, you know. Gospel of Matthew or something, and they'll just stick to that, and then they'll go to skip the book of Acts, because, you know, that's just for the first century, and then they'll maybe go to some of Paul's writings, and then they'll ponder over what the book of Revelation means, when the meanings of the book of Revelation are, a lot of them are found in the Torah, a lot of them are even found in the book of Enoch, you know, as I've made videos about. So again, it's just like dispensationalism is all right, but you got to read the entire Bible. And as this verse is saying, he that turns away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer shall be an abomination. Even his prayer shall be an abomination. So what does that mean? So many people indirectly, and sometimes I've just been moved to pray for certain YouTubers, like, I won't name them, that there was one who was basically living in a room, and I just prayed that he find his wife from his own kindred, you know, from his own sort of background, if you know what I mean, and prayed for him to move state, because the state they were in wasn't exactly the best place to be. I remember praying for that brother, and within a few months, you know, he met his, you know, or she was moved to contact him, and then he moved out there to be with her. another YouTuber prayed about, asked his subscribers, which is me, to pray for land, because they were, you know, they needed a place to bring up their children and, you know, have their ministry and all this stuff, and prayed for them. And sure enough, within a few months, they were shown this place, and then they took this place, and they're still there today. I remember my best man, when I get married, he was in severe depression, and he asked me to pray for him to get a wife, and I prophesied that he'd meet a girl from California, which he did, and he got married to her. And so what does this mean? Does this mean that hopefully it means it should tell you that I'm born again. But what it should also tell you is that I'm not one who turns their ear away from hearing the law. So my prayers aren't an abomination. When I'm interceding and praying for others, it's almost like an instantaneous thing that happens in the heavenlies. And I'm not there to collect these people's respect, praise, thanks. Oh, thanks, John, for praying for me. A lot of the people I pray for, they've probably never even spoken to me before, personally. Some of the ones I showed up, as I've said, made a couple of videos about, spoke God's word for one of the women to bear a child, even though, you know, they're from an ex Jehovah's Witness background. And all I did was just speak God's word. And within a year, I was actually holding that child on my lap. and the child was sick over me, and I looked up at that point and I saw like a bright light in the sky moving, and I just knew it was an angel, and it was God saying that you know, God has heard the prayer that I said, or the word that I spoke, and he acted upon what I said. And so, you know, this has happened very, 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 very many, many times in my life. And so I don't say that to boast. I just say that in order to give you, the Christian, the viewer, the believer in Yeshua, Jesus Christ, the chance to intercede for other believers as well. Yes, I need intercessory prayer as well. Any brothers or sisters out there that wants to pray for me in my situation, my situation is that, of course, I have quite a few situations in my life, to be honest, but one is the most important thing for me is my son. I just pray that his mother will sign the rights over to me, if it's God's will, to look after him, because, you know, he's staying in another country just now, and as far as I understood years ago, that it was definitely God's will for me to have him. But, you know, due to paperwork and different things, and into the grandmother's illiteracy, because a lot of them, like where I was, they're unable to sort of fill out forms. So it really needs a miraculous intervention by the Lord in, on my son's behalf, and that the Lord leads me in that situation. You know, I've asked for prayers from others, but I just feel yet that you know, that the Lord has been moving people to help me, but they've been distracted from Satan, because Satan basically fights very hard against the things which you know, have been given to me by the Lord. You just won't believe some of the things that happen. They're just they are supernatural, and they are of the kingdom of Satan. So yes, any of you out there who are interceders, prayer warriors, please pray for me, as I have prayed for others and seen the fruit of that. And that's all I would ask in that situation. Yes, I would like prayers as well for my ministry here in the UK, because there's sort of a lot of disruption, and as you probably guess when you're watching my videos, a little bit of infighting. You know, it's not like serious, like venomous stuff, but it's just like people that don't want to see things the way I see them. I see things very simply. You know, Jesus died for our sin. That blood that was shed at the cross of Calvary means that I'm saved by grace, by faith in him, and not by the law. okay? But I realise that when we are saved, we actually begin to have a heart for the law, you see? So it kind of works in reverse, you see? I mean, the Jews try to do things by the law first and to be good little Jews and then to get eternal life. It doesn't work like that. You know, you got to confess you're a sinner and we're saved by faith, by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. And then we have an affinity with the law, and then we can hear the law, and we can even understand it. A lot of Jewish people, they'll hear the law very willingly. They'll go to a synagogue, but not many has the spirit of understanding. Not that many. You know, it's written in the book of Yeshaya, chapter 11, verses 1 and 2, about the seven spirits of the Lord, which is, I call it the dimensions of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, I mean, I was speaking to a woman last year and I just gave her that verse. I says, I feel very strongly the Lord wants to give you this verse. And she just about broke down and she was like, I've been quoting and praying that verse every single day for the past year. So I had witnesses there. It wasn't just, I'm not making it up. I'm not here so as to get followers or anything. As I said, I'm here to share the word of God. I'm here so that you, the viewer, the subscriber, the Christian, the believer, might benefit from your faith in Jesus Christ, that your faith isn't in vain, and you begin to realise that you begin to move in faith according to your calling, according to your gifting, you see. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. It's not about following my little ideals and the way I see things. I hope that, I mean, I know that people get something from watching the videos. That's the most important thing. They get a clearer understanding about things. Hopefully less of a hatred towards maybe Jewish people. Less of a hatred towards races and cultures. I mean, our culture, whatever culture we've inherited, if we're born again, it should become more like what the biblical God's people, you know, should be like. Because remember that, you know, Israel really turned away from God, and a lot of their culture was lost in paganism. So you really got to understand the Lord desires things to be done His way. The Lord desires us to congregate on the new moons and Sabbath. He desires these things for us, but He wants us to do it in the right spirit, you know. He wants us to have understanding about His times and laws, which we know the Antichrist changes these times and laws. I mean, you know, we thought in the past that it could just be a new calendar. Maybe it's just going to be a Sunday law, which is possible. You know, I know Ron Wyatt spoke about that, that it's just going to be this Sunday law that's just going to come out, which is possible. But then again, the way things are going with CERN and all of that, it seems that the times and laws, it seems the very laws of creation are being manipulated somehow by somewhere, something, some supernatural occurrences. And I just think in the back of my mind, I watched a video the other day, and it's two Christians, a couple of women, that were talking about the technology that's associated with CERN. And it's kind of like this. If you get a computer program and you go on a computer and your program that you can go back in time if you want, you know, you've got your timeline there, and let's say you want to change something in the program back here that's going to, and you just want to see how it's going to affect this, so that you can sort of run the program first. You can just drop something in to this, like 1945, just drop something in there. And then the ripples of everything sort of ripples around that, and then you can see how it affects the time that we're living in just now. I think it's something along these lines, in that they change sort of major things in the world, or I've even heard about, there's a lot of history in New York City that's been changed. You know, that there was actually New York City, there was not a dirty bomb, but there was a huge bomb that went off. I think it was before the Second World War, and it caused a lot of the houses around, you know, the area between New York and New Jersey to be destroyed, and no one could remember that thing happening. And that there's a few other things that, obviously, painting the boats like a zebra-like colour, never seen the light before. You know, when I was, I believe I was being called to join the Navy at a certain point, and I had to study, you know, a little bit of naval history, naval commanders and so on, things like that. And I never saw any books or any of that sort with the zebra painting on the boats or the U-boats. Never saw that in my life. And of course, there's videos being made of that, and this is a type of Mandela effect. We watch so many movies, some of things about the Nazi Bell, some other things that I've put on my channel to do with time travel. There's obviously Back to the Future. You know, Hollywood has been making movies about time travel for a long time. I think Hellboy, that movie has got Nazis opening up space gates, you know, according to these sort of, you know, the round gates and steps up to them and all of that stuff. You know, I think that's in that movie. Whether that in fact is associated with something that is real, it could well be. I mean, because none of us truly know really the extent of what's going on out there. None of us know everything, that's for certain. In fact, a lot of Christians are quite willfully ignorant, which is, to me, suggests that they're people that will not willingly hear the law. They will not willingly hear God's commandments. They will not willingly read them. They will not willingly just even hear them, you see. And so sometimes I understand that God does miracles in order to alert a person that they should be hearing the Torah. They should be giving up certain traditions and things which are against God's law. They should be growing in the Lord, you see. Not obeying the law to have salvation. You have salvation through Jesus Christ. But if you want to grow in the Lord, I think it's essential that you should be refined. That was the first scripture I got before I got baptized, over 20 years ago now, was a scripture from Malachi, that I shall refine you like silver 7 times. I actually got that scripture without actually reading it. And it was about 3 or 4 years later, by the time my life got less crazy enough, although it's not as crazy as it was 20 years ago, but it's not settled my life. My family situation has suffered very much. I think deep down it's because of choices I made a long time ago, and it's not really because of any particular events that's happened within these relationships. I really tend to think that it's because I made wrong choices quite a while ago, and I've kind of suffered for that over the past few years. But I know that God pours out His mercy and grace upon me and continues to bless me. And I think that we have choices to make in life, dear friends, you know. But, you know, God just wants to know if we want to keep on pressing into Him, keep on praying for His guidance in life and His mercy. And He keeps on giving it. He keeps on giving me it. And it's just that God knows how men and women look at each other in this life. And it's very sad that there's a lot of worldly Christians out there who will judge you for the clothes you wear, the job you do, how you look, that type of thing. There's the church, including the people I've been walking with and have been doing street preaching with, they still think as men and women of the world. I'm well aware of that, you know. And it's something that we really almost just can't escape, unfortunately, in this life. It's just the way that men and women judge each other is according to their status, their standing, their past, you know, their sort of image that they project of themselves, which a lot of is a load of crap. I'm not fazed by what clothes people wear, how they tend to try and portray their image, you know, as this, you know, as a sort of a mysterious, travelling, you know, preacher and all that nonsense. Jesus just says, seek my kingdom first and my righteousness, or God's righteousness. Everything you need shall be added to you. Don't worry about the things you wear and the food you eat. You know, as you can see, you know, if you watch my videos, I'm not a person that worries about anything, any worldly things, the clothes I wear, you know, and the food I eat as well. You know, if I pray for food from the Lord, I know it's going to be nutritious. I know it's going to be good food that the Lord is going to provide, like manna was what he provided the Israelites. I know it's going to be something very nutritious, you know, for my body. He's not going to give me a bacon sandwich. It's just not going to happen, you know. Even though I've heard in the past people have prayed for bacon sandwiches and then people have just given them bacon sandwiches. If I pray to the Lord, that will not happen, I can guarantee it. There's even a church locally, as I've said before, that you go in on a Sunday morning and they actually hand you a bacon roll or a bacon sandwich and a cup of tea, even if you want it or not. And if you like toss it in the bin, they're like so offended, which I've actually done before. And the guy got so offended and he just wanted to argue with me. It's really funny. But yeah. So the proverb here that we were discussing, he that turneth away his ear from hearing the law, even his prayer shall be an abomination. So the obvious question is, how is it that all these faith healers and all these guys can go out? They don't seem to have any care about the law. And they can go out and heal people on a whim. I'm not talking about major healings. I'm talking about sore heads, sore backs, right? I'm not talking about real healings. I'm just talking about like faith healings, faith-based healings. You know, do you believe that the blood that we shed at Calvary, by his stripes you are healed? Do you believe that? Let me pray for your sore head. Yes, I believe Jesus died for me so I can have perfect health. And all of a sudden, you know, their sore head goes or their sore back disappears. It's just a matter of faith, you know, that if you come into agreement with another believer and you have a sore back or whatever it is, you know, you tend to get healed. On the other occasion, a little bit more advanced from that, you know, you can get people that go out and basically stand and intercede for people. So these are unbelievers and they're willing to put themselves in the way and stand in the gap for that person and say, the Lord wants to heal your leg, or I can get you off crutches, and they'll laugh and the person prays and then they get healed. That normally happens for unbelievers. It has happened for believers in the past. It just depends on the will of God, but usually that's a sign for unbelievers to bring them to faith, you see. And so, you know, people that can do that, I would say, are a little bit more advanced. I think they're doing things a little bit more the way the Lord wants to do them. But in saying that, hold on a second. You know, these things are just faith-based issues, you know, to do with, delivering a word which will ignite your faith a little bit in the Lord, okay? But as we know, you know, one leper came back and thanked Jesus for healing them. So, and there was like nobody in Capernaum. You know, I went to Capernaum when I was in Israel, and it's just a little, it's not even a village. I think it's just got one shop, it's a little diner, and that's it. You know, and Jesus says, did speak against these cities because they never obviously repented of their sin and followed him. And so, hallelujah. Please be encouraged to at least hear the law rather than things which just temporarily give you some sort of little faith boost thing. If you're about hearing God's law, you're going to have a far deeper, more meaningful walk with the Lord Jesus Christ, with Yeshua the Messiah. It will deepen your walk and it will deepen your faith in the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, the way I see it sometimes is a little bit like resistance training. You know, the obvious thing just isn't to go along happily with the easy things. Sometimes things which challenge us actually produce make us sort of make these roots go down deeper. You know, if we're challenged, it means we really have to. Sometimes you have to look within ourselves, but more importantly, we have to look to the Lord, and we really have. And on that occasion, it sort of deepens our faith when we're challenged. You know, that's by something we read in Scripture. Obviously, for example, things like, should we still keep a Sabbath as Christians? And if so, which days are the Sabbath days, you see? And these are very challenging questions. A lot of Christians won't even hear that. And their lives will, you know, God won't really use them for any miraculous things, sadly. And I'm not saying that they have to hear God's Torah to start producing miracles, but I think that it's essential that you do. I think it's essential that you do, especially for the ones that are really standing in the gap for people, the ones that are prepared to put themselves out there and make themselves even look foolish, and take the risk that maybe even some prayers won't even work, you know, in order just to exercise their faith, as our body has to be exercised and our mind has to be fed and exercised, so does our spirit, so does our soul. Hallelujah. So hope this has been challenging enough for you, and I'll see you in the next video, guys. Shalom.